may be seated.
Will your grace surround us?
Praise the Lord. That was beautiful. That was beautiful. Welcome to Fire and Water. Praise God. How y'all doing? Not very lively. How y'all doing? Anyone with a pulse in here? Someone breathing? My goodness. Y'all sleeping? The lights aren't bright enough. Make them brighter. Turn the heat up. Wake up! You're in church. Praise God. We're here to worship God. Amen? We're here to worship Jesus. We're here. We don't have any other agenda. There's no secret deal going on behind the doors. It's about Jesus. It's about the Savior that loves you. 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 That's what it's all about. That's why we're here. Nothing else, but simply because God has been so good to us. Those of us that have come into the kingdom of God because the love of God moved on the Spirit of God and the Son of God came down that we could know him, that we could receive forgiveness for our sins. Amen? So this now, what's happening next, what's going to happen after, everything that's going to happen is going to have to do with Jesus. It's going to have to do with the resurrection, with the greatest love in the world. And we want you to be a part of that, okay? Amen? Whether it's your first time coming here as a guest or if you've come here and even, you know, whoever you are, God loves you. He's moved by faith and by compassion for what you're going through. He cares. He really, really, really cares. And so please, if anything good can happen today, come out of religion. Come out of habit. Maybe you came here because this is what you do on a Sunday, or this is what you do in your family. Come out of that and come here to encounter a person named Jesus. Okay? You'll never be the same. And it does matter for eternity. Amen? Who are our first-time guests? Praise the Lord. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. Welcome. God bless you. Welcome. Everybody, we're going to wave at the camera for a moment here. Amen. God bless you. Welcome. We never knew who's going to be watching now or in the future. Amen. But we're glad you're here. Do me a favor. Look at the person next to you. Say, I'm glad you're here. Amen. 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 Okay, pastor said we didn't really mean it, so we got to do it again, and we'll have to keep doing it until we... So look at your neighbor, say, I'm really glad you're here. I'm really glad you're here. Okay, all right. Now open your wallet, and... no, just... Amen. One more time, amen? I'm really glad you're here. Sincerely, I'm really glad you're here. I'm really glad you're here. Amen? Praise God. But this is part of ministry. For those of you that thought you can't do ministry, you just did. If you meant it from your heart for Jesus, you just were ministering. And that's all you need to keep doing is do the same thing. From your heart, express the love of God. Welcome people into the church. Welcome people into the family of God. That's ministry. It doesn't have a title. You don't have to go to Bible school for what you just did you? Amen? Congratulations. You'll get a paper afterwards now. Praise God. So, but seriously, keep doing that. That's what this is about. People will die in the next 30 seconds somewhere, wherever they are, in Phoenix and wherever. People are going to continue leaving this earth, and they may leave without Christ, but we have an opportunity for every person we encounter to minister. And it's really deep. It's God bless you. It's welcoming them. It's loving them. It's sharing the good news with them. It's sharing what Jesus did in your heart, because you honestly, and I'm speaking firsthand myself for a situation very recently where you just don't know when you share something what's going to happen a minute later and see an emergency vehicle a minute later. I just want to take 1 second because this is, I mean, literally, I just, yesterday the Lord put it on my heart where to share. And speaking for myself, we're all called to share, so it doesn't really matter where, but just be obedient. And it can be challenging when you're not comfortable. But the person that didn't necessarily listen to what I wanted to say, I clearly, when I went to leave the area I was in sharing the gospel, go to my vehicle, and there's someone laid out on their back with their hands on their chest. And an emergency vehicle siren is coming into the area. And that situation, that person was the person of several people that was passing by as I was sharing the good news. Literally. So I say that to you because we do not know and we take for granted the time we have and the people that we can touch the lives of. So please be aware of that because we take it for granted. We do not know. And we can only do what we can do. It's not my job or your job to save anybody. You can't. It's your job to share. It's God's job to save. So you don't beat yourself up. But I wanted to share that because it's been bothering me. And not to look at me, just you look to him and do what he's telling you to do. But do what you're responsible for and let him do the rest, okay? Because we really, the problem with the gospel is not the gospel. It's there's a sense of urgency that's missing in the people hearing it. That's what I heard, and it just really spoke to me when I was sharing yesterday, is that when you share, it's not the idea of, hey, think about this for a few days, maybe this, maybe that. It's, listen, this is urgent. You do not know what you have left time-wise. You do not know what's going to happen today. Your heart is not beating because you're regulating it. It's because of the grace of God. When you go to sleep at night and you're still breathing while you're sleeping, it's not because you're thinking about it. It's because he's letting you. We do not have a moment guaranteed of any sort in this world. So it's urgent when you share the good news to at least put that to someone and say, listen, I'm not trying to be pushy, but I am trying to be real. You do not know what's going to happen when you try to cross the street. Try and cross the streets in Phoenix. All joking aside, people get hit all the time for either the driver or the people. You can't count on anything. You can't count on anything. Count on Christ. Put your faith in him. Stop playing around if you're playing around with God, because that's dangerous business. And take it seriously. There is an urgency to the decision. If you don't know the Lord, it's urgent that you think about what I'm saying. It's not a game. Because our choices or our rejection of Christ has eternal significance. So it's not. It's urgent. It's important. It's a now decision. Not a later. Maybe later. I'll think about it next week. God's not stupid. God is not stupid. Well, I'm not. You know what? Right before I die. But that's what people think. Right before I die, God's not stupid. Who says he's going to give you the opportunity to do it that way? Okay? So don't play games. Anyway, I just, thank you. Praise God. To think about your choices and bring the urgency when you share the good news. And because it's so important and everything is centered around Jesus, we have an outreach this Saturday. That's at 9:30. That's your opportunity to minister again really deeply by saying, hello, I'm from Fire and Water. Love to invite you to church. Sharing the gospel. So come here at 9:30 if you're available and you value the time that you have. Come here if you're available, or pray for that outreach. Show up after we have some coffee and whatever else. Go out into the neighborhood, invite people to the kingdom of God, invite people to this church. Amen? Amen. Amen. The me I want to be, becoming God's best version of you. Don't stay version 1.0. You know what I mean? You get something and they always upgrade, especially if it's certain software. It's version 1, version 1.2. Don't stay version 1 of yourself. Come to this program. Amen? You don't want to stay the way you came out from the factory. I don't. So you got to show up to do that, though. You have to go into a process. You have to be exposed to something different or you'll stay the same. So there's great ministry going on, great pastors that are going to be here Wednesday nights, 6:30 p.m. There's childcare available. Come here and learn and receive what God has for you so you can be more like Christ. Amen? Perfect version. Children's choir practice today following the service. We've got practice for Easter Sunday coming up. We only have 4 Sundays for this. Your kids should want to be excited about coming to church. You don't want them to be like, again, this is their opportunity. We're talking about kids that are 2 years up and older. Okay, 2 years and older, come. So if you can, please stay after the service for this. It's not going to be eternally long, but it's going to be eternally important. Amen? Let them get a touch and a taste of what it's like to do something for the Lord. And it's going to be for Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday. Because he's alive, because he's risen. Amen? Amen. Amen. And then we're going to get ready now to take the offering. Pastor John, would you bless us by praying for the offering, please?
Our most precious Heavenly Father, in the name and by the blood of Jesus, Father, we thank you for the privilege of being able to give unto you, Lord. And Father, we ask you to bless our offerings today, dear God. Bless the people that are able to give and the people that aren't able to give, dear God. But We just thank you, Lord, for this day. Prepare our hearts for the word that's going to go forth today. We thank you and we ask you this in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Please remain seated as the conquerors go ahead and minister.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Welcome to Fire and Water International Church Outreach. Saturday morning, this is where we go out there and just share the good news, the good gospel news, where Jesus Christ died for all our sins, past, present, and future. So join me as we go out there and share the love of God.
Introduce me to Christ. Thank you.
her first time here. And so we didn't, and she just wants to bless her mom and her family that's here. And we didn't get to practice much, but we're going to let her sing and bless her mom. And let's just cheer on, too. Thank you.
Thank you. the one who made the blind to see, is moving here in front of me, moving here in front of me. The one who made the deaf to hear, is silencing my every fear, silencing my every fear. I believe in you, I believe in you. You're the God of miracles. I believe in you, I believe in you. You're the God of
everybody. Do you believe he's the same yesterday, today, and forever? And if he healed back then, he heals right now. Come on. If that's you, lift up your hands. Come on. Come on. Yeah, 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 yeah. Still healing, still delivering, still setting the captives free. Come on. Resurrection power.
The God who brings the dead to life.
Raised Jesus from the grave.
Is
the same resurrection power that's here right now. And with him all things are possible. Do you believe it? Shout yeah! Shout yeah!
Come on.
With him all things are possible.
The power of the risen one.
Yeah. Bible says, if you believe, you shall see my glory. If you believe, you shall see my glory. Do you believe in this place that with God all things are possible? Do you believe His word? In Psalms 103, it says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name, that forgives all my sins and heals all my diseases. Do you believe? Do you believe that He's the same yesterday, today, and forever? Do you believe the same God that opened up the Red Sea for Moses and all of Israel to cross over is the same God that's here right now that wants to open up? New door that only He can open up and that no man can shut. Do you believe that what God opens up, no man can shut, and He gets all the glory? Do you believe that? Do you believe He's still healing today? He's still delivering today? He's still setting the captives free today? He's still making the crooked places straight today? Do you believe it? Shout yeah! Show ya!
You're the God of miracles. I believe in you. I believe in you. You're the God of miracles.
Say it again.
I believe in you.
Yeah. Watch this. Greatest miracle of all. Greatest miracle of all is a soul getting saved. It's sad. It's sad. That when you're having an altar call for salvation, let me fix some of us in this room. And all my holier than thou saints that have been in it forever and come in with the Bible and all the praise the Lords. There is a problem when people are getting saved at the altar, which is the greatest miracle of all. Jesus came to find that which was lost. That is what it's all about. This is why we gather. This is why we lift up His name. This is why we do what we do. Not here. We're not here gathering to go to entertain. This is life and death. And it's sad. When people are getting saved and you're witnessing because you're like, man, miracles, and man, I just want to see God move and I want to see God do this. You're witnessing the greatest miracle of all, and we get up sometimes during the altar call because it doesn't pertain to us, or we look at our watch so the You may be seated for a second. You guys stay right there. You know, just stay right there. Leave the lights where they're at. It's thick. So the clay is telling the potter, the invention is telling the inventor how to run things. You know, I got this, and I got to be here, and I got to do this. Got to be Same people that cry out, I want to see God move. Same people that rush off to a football game because we don't want to miss the football. And by the way, football's over, so relax right now. So no one should be going anywhere. But you're the same ones. They're like, oh! And you're witnessing the great. What are you? What I can see God looking up. Like, what are you? You're asking to see me move on your behalf. I'm moving on your behalf. Miracles are happening, and you're getting up and leaving at an altar call. But physically, though, or you hear about a healer, healing ministry come into town, and people will line up for hours and stay for hours. They're like, wow, what happened now? What happened? And God is in the healing business physically also. But the greatest miracle is salvation. Because when death comes knocking at our door, it's not the end, it's only the beginning. So my question is, how do we not have a problem waiting in line to witness? My God, did you see this? Did you see that? Did you know this is happening over here? And you won't believe what I saw over here. And this is, and that's happening. And in the physical, and this happened, stuff happened. And man, you should have seen, you know, the manifestation of God. And manifestation, okay. Well, this is what's happening. And God's pouring out his glory. And you'll hear also, and you won't believe it. Someone got this, and this miracle that took place, and this turned into gold, and this and that. My question is, at the end of all that, did anybody get saved? No. You can't handle that, because some of you are like, whoa. Did anybody get saved? When God did stuff and miracles took place, it was to get people's attention also to get saved. And we run around. And by the way, the devil also can do some stuff also. Greatest miracle of all. I believe in miracles. Is when someone gets saved. And tomorrow's not guaranteed to anybody. And I'm excited right now because this is really, as I said last night, because this isn't. Trust me, I'm not looking for this. Somebody, oh, he's just saying that to me. No, I'm not looking for this. Trust me. That is not what gets me up. That is not the reason why. Oh my God, if I don't get up, if I give up and give in, oh my God, I'm gonna lose all this. The thing gets me up. Some of the people that are in here that were ready to take their lives or people had given up on and had no, were hopeless, and I hear their stories, have come out of prison, and now they're serving God, and because of a television program or something that happened here, the thing that gets me up, Jamie, is when I hear the story that you came here and you were high and you're addicted to heroin, and during the praise and worship, who cares about all this? If we're not, all this isn't working for this, then it's, I want a cute program, and I want something that's anointed, that God's name's going to be glorified, and when people leave, they leave free, delivered, saved for the glory of God. And they're not talking about a church or a pastor or a name or something, but they're talking about this. I had an encounter with Jesus. Amen. That's what gets me up when I hear the story. I battled many things in my life, just like we all do. But trust me, I don't keep on going because I'm going to lose my position. Oh, I'm not going to get a chance to. I'm not going to be on TV. What keeps me going, and the only thing that makes sense to me, is when I hear, like, Jamie coming in this place, saying I was on heroin, I was addicted, and during the praise and worship, right where I was sitting, I was set free and have never touched the drugs ever again. That's what done. And no one else can get the glory but God Himself. Well, I didn't listen to that. You can't. Only God gets the glory. Stories like that. Just for a moment. Do you guys want to hear of another miracle? Just for a few minutes. Rustin, praise the Lord. Why don't you come up here? Praise the Lord. Why don't you, this is what it's about. Are you ready? Shut up, ready. Why don't you share a little bit, like, okay, just who you are, your background, and just what led you, you know.
Sure. All right, hi, everybody. My name is Rustin, if you don't know me already. I'm not particularly good at public speaking, so I really just typed something up so then I could just read it and it would be a lot easier and a lot less nerve-wracking. So sorry if it seems routine and rote, but it is. Okay, so essentially what it comes down to is when I met you all, I was misleading you. I was misleading every one of you. I began attending Fire and Water in November. I'd been dating my best friend for a while, and at that point, she invited me to join her for church. She had spoke so highly of the church and everybody here so often, I felt that I already knew many of you before I ever even attended. To support the woman I love, I was happy to come and be a part of her experience and share in all of this and try to support her in everything she does and her praise and worship and meet all of her friends and all the people who she loves and by extension I love. But really what it comes down to is the full truth is that I enjoyed attending the church. I had fun every time. It was a blast. It was exciting. Everybody was so nice and sweet. But the truth is, for 20 years, I've identified as a purposeful atheist. And that's not to say that I just was not aware by purposeful. I mean, I purposefully rejected the idea of a higher power. And it was always just a matter of, if I can't see it, I don't believe it. It's not real. It's not there. I need evidence, science, science, science. The longer I attended, the more deeply I enjoyed what I was experiencing. And I don't think Brother Charlie's here today. Okay. So then he can't yell at me for poorly quoting him, but one day he did say that something to the effect of, you don't really know the spirit until it passes through you and hits the person in front of you. And I witnessed that every time I came, every Saturday night, every Sunday. And it was beautiful. It rang true in my core. The effect the church had on so many lives. I realized I'm witnessing a miracle anytime I look at every single one of you here. And it moved me. I see love and beauty in every one of you. On February 11th, during a prayer during sermon, we held hands with our neighbors. I closed my eyes and felt his presence in me. It felt as though I were holding on for my life, and I was. But more importantly, I was holding on for my soul. I couldn't stop weeping. Brother Dave came to me and asked if I would like to go up for altar call, and I was hesitant. But I worked up the courage to say yes. Dave prayed with me, and I felt warmth and love and have since been a changed man. For as long as I can remember, I've fought a fight against depression and self-harm. Since accepting Jesus as my Savior, my daily thoughts of suicide and the desire to cut myself have dissolved. My heart and mind are filled with hope and positivity rather than self-loathing and desperation. I've learned that I am worthy of the love of the Lord, and I can now say that I'm anointed, I'm dangerous, and a mighty voice for God. So to close, Pastor Gus always says, it's not the way you start, it's the way you finish, and I'm going to finish strong. Will you marry me?
Yeah. That's what it's about. I said, that's what it's about. That's what it's about. That's what it's about.
I believe in you. You're the God of miracles. I believe in you. I believe in you. You're the God. God of miracles. I believe in you. I believe in you. You're the God of miracles. The God who was and is to come. The power.
God we serve. We don't serve a dead God. We serve a resurrected King. Yeah. And with Him all things are possible. Yeah, yeah.
You're the God of miracles.
And it's not the way you start. It is the way you finish.
the God of miracles.
Watch this. Just real quick. You may be seated. I'm trying to get something across here. You don't end up here unless she invites you. So it wasn't a church building that brought you to church. It wasn't the landscape of, oh my God, look at that beautiful sanctuary. 20 years, you said, right? 20 years? Didn't believe. Somebody invited you. And I'm sure during that process, she shared experiences in her something. I think it goes something like this. Some of her testimony. She testified. So you don't get saved. You do not have your encounter with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So when the altar call was made, and David said to go up to the altar, right? I'm trying to get. So was it? The whole miracle started. Someone brought you to church. Somebody said something Monday through Friday. If no one invites you, there's an altar call, but there's no one to come to the altar, and there's no one to ask next to you to come to the altar, because there's no one here to ask to go to the altar, because no one has shared their testimony. Doesn't matter how great the preaching. It's not about all this works together. All together, everyone works together so we can have the end result of what's happening right now. The Bible says one plants, another waters, but God brings the increase. The miracle, the changing of the heart is God's business. But one plants, another waters. Someone's got to do something to let somebody know that there's an answer and his name is Jesus. Someone's got to. Make themselves available. And make a stance. Someone needs to make themselves available and maybe bring somebody to church that doesn't have a car. In other words. And then you were impacted by the love and what you saw. But let me say this also. The greatest sermon that we are going to preach, that you're going to preach, I'm tired of hearing, I want to do ministry. This was high level ministry right here. I said, this is what ministry's about. We have reduced this thing like ministries. If I have a pulpit in front of me, or an instrument, or I have a position in the church, and then Monday through Friday, nobody even knows that you're a Christian. This is ministry. Let me say something. And it's going to cost you something also. And sacrifice will come along you. Remember, commitment and sacrifice, your little buddies. Because who you run with is a prophecy of your future. I said, who you run with is a prophecy of your future. And let me tell you, if you're going to do something great for God, and we're going to see God move and touch lives for His glory and do it and finish strong for His glory, amen, you got to run. Because who are you running with? If you're running with commitment and sacrifice, you'll do something great for His glory, amen? No, listen. Yesterday, somebody said, man, you are like, seem like you're upset. Well, that was nothing. Watch what I'm about to do right now in 5 minutes, amen. It's like that was too much. No, because you know the reality is this. This is the truth. So why can someone just say it? We come in church. We dress up. If death came knocking at his door, he didn't have a relationship with Jesus. He didn't believe. He was under the title of an atheist. So we come in, we have all the right sayings, we dress the parts, and the world we live in, oh, look how nice they are, or look, what a family, and they go to church on Sunday. But it's comfortable. It fits in our skin. Okay, this, we'll put in our time here. God, look, we showed up. You know when you're really doing something worthwhile? Because some of us in here need to hear and watching at home. You want to do something great. You want to be you. Oh, we want to see changes and we want to see our city change and we want to see our country change. If my people, look at somebody and say, he's speaking to you right now. If my people who are called by my name, watch me, will humble themselves and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. So we want to see change, but we're not watching. We're asking for change, and we're asking to do, and we're asking to be involved, but the involvement is only in our comfort zone. In my comfort zone. I see a move of God. It's not going to come in our comfort zone. It's not going to be comfortable. You can't have a resurrection without a crucifixion. So let's be real here. Sit here and go through our little religious exercises and say, oh, this was nice, and no one's talking about the reality of this. Great moves of God took place where the church was persecuted, people died for the cause. Are you willing to die for the cause? Really? You can't even handle a word of correction. Yeah, I'll die for Jesus. You can't even handle a rebuke. Smile. Look at everybody and say, it's going to be all right. You know what it is to call? You know what? You know what? Just trying to. When you make yourself aware and say, okay, I might have to change my schedule around a little bit. I might have to cancel my movie night. Pause. Maybe some of the money that I spend, or maybe that new shirt that I was going to get, or, you know, I'm just using some example here. Or maybe I can, instead of getting this size of a TV, I can get the smaller size and take the rest of the money that I have, give it to the church so they can put buses so we can bring more people to church. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Now you're getting into my business. I can handle going to church. I can handle, okay, come on now. I mean, I'm getting up in the morning and I could have slept in. And here I am, and I showed up, and I had my Bible. I even sang my songs. Look at someone say, big deal. You come talk to me when you're planning on buying something and you don't even buy it. Forget the smaller size. You touch it. I'm going to give it to something bigger than myself. It's getting a little crazy now, huh? Let me go a little further. How about a car that's sitting around in the garage? How about, you know, the Bible talks about that as God moved, and there was a move of God, persecution was taking place, people were dying for the cause, and you know what the church did? Would sell their possessions and bring it to the apostles' feet. Where's that today? Their possessions. Let me talk to somebody. Maybe let's watch you. Who's got that extra house? You want to really do something for God? How about, you know what? It's nice to have this over here. But you know what? How cool would it be to just donate it to the church so it could turn into a discipleship home? Or how about we donate the house out of the three houses that we might have? But man, you don't know, man. That costs this much money. Yeah, I didn't know it was your money anyway. And let me say one more thing. Can I say one more thing? Because I'm going to say it anyway. You know our stuff's not going with us to heaven. And some of us are building our little kingdoms thinking they're just putting up residence here. It's temporary. The Bible says what's seen is temporary. What's unseen is everlasting. What is a profit of man to gain the whole world? To lose a soul. And to lose a soul. God blesses us because he does want to bless us so we can be a blessing, so that people can hear our testimony and we can point them to Jesus and let the people know, this is the God we serve. This is how awesome he is. This is how much. This is where I was, and look at where I'm at now. Yeah. How about that? Do we know what it means to pay a price? Selling a house or just giving the house. How about a family that now started off hopeless, a family was broken, and now by the relationship has been brought together, restoration. Maybe someone came out of prison, the other one off the street, and now the kids that were taken away have been brought back to them, and now we have a family and three kids that don't have a place, and they're real, and God's started a miracle in their lives, and they just need need some of the people of God that say they're the people of God to start to come along with them and help them as they continue to press in, because they're doing everything they know possible to the best of it, because they're not going back. They're not doing what they used to do. But you know what I'm saying? When you first started, did you ever get when you needed just $100 or maybe or something, or there was a need, and all of a sudden somebody in church came up to you, didn't know your situation, shook your hand, and in their hand, when you opened it up, when they walked away, there was $100 bill. You're thinking, oh my God, things like that. I've witnessed it, because when I got saved, my pastor that went to be in heaven, when I didn't have a vehicle, gave me one of those, and it wasn't $100, it was $1,000, and he said, don't tell anybody. This is to help you get a car. Are you hearing me? I want to hear about you and how many scriptures you know and how long you've been coming to church. My pastor was serving God for many years. It cost him a lot. Impacted his family because of it. He would bring people in his own home. Streets. That sacrifice. And I know we all can't go to that, but watch this. But I could tell you that $1,000 didn't come from the church, that came from him directly. He saw that somebody was moving forward and needed some help to keep pushing forward. And yes, it's the Lord. God loves you. God cares about you. But yeah, we're hungry. We need a roof over our head. We need some help. Who's going to step out? Who's going to give up something for something greater? Who's going to give up our self-centeredness? Because that's what it comes down to. We say Jesus, but our actions are saying, I'm not Christ-centered. I'm actually self-centered. My actions are saying, I love you. No, wait a second. Then it becomes, well, it's about him. And we're like, yes. Well, if it's about him, we'll have fruit that follows. I'm speaking to myself also, so take it easy. I need this. And God, and everything that we have, who gave you the ability to even be in the position you're in? Who gave you the wisdom? Who gave you the strength? Who gave you the ability to acquire what you have in the first place? This is awesome. And this is what it's about. Want to do something great? How about waking up on Saturday morning? Let's go out on the street. At least pray or just something. I know we can't all be here because we all do different things. I'm just saying, but some of us say can. A lot of people say, I want to get involved. Well, okay, and you got your Saturday morning available. And then you leave disgruntled, upset, and it's the church's fault. Well, I had all these, they didn't use me, and I told them I want to be used. How about you just show up on a Saturday morning when you're able to show up? Oh, but that's not in a spotlight where you're going to get the applause. If you're looking at a man, you're in the wrong business. And you're in the wrong house also. The greatest among them is a servant. Do I got any servants in the house? Do I got any soldiers in the house? Do I got any soldiers in the house? Are you all right? You don't have to. I just screen. This is in John chapter 4, where the Samaritan woman has an encounter with Jesus at the well.
She's not living for God. She's not going to church. To be honest with you, she pretty much has had it with church people. Yeah, I just said something and only one person caught it. She's had it because of all the judging and the criticizing and looking down on her because of her lifestyle. You know the story. And watch this. Jesus, verse 10. Let's go for time's sake real quick. Verse 13. So there's an encounter. They're at the well. Jesus is asking for water. And here's the dialogue. Jesus answered, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw the water. He told her, go call your husband and come back. I have no husband, she replied. Jesus said to her, you're right when you say you have no husband. The fact is you have five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have, right? True. Okay, watch this. So she's not going to church. She's not living right. And by the way, this is happening outside the four walls of the church. And this is Jesus. Now watch this. And we know the spirit that Jesus communicates to the woman is with the right heart and with much love. Truth, but with a lot of love. Because we know, as we read the story a little bit further down, a little further along in our text, that there's been a change in her life. See, sometimes we're trying to speak truth also, but we're doing it with the wrong spirit. And no one's listening, because as soon as you start to share truth, and it could be accurate what you're sharing or telling somebody, but it's with the wrong spirit. And a wall goes up, so it doesn't matter what you're saying because no one's listening. That's another thing. Look at somebody and say, that's another thing. We're good at quoting scripture, carrying the Bible, knowing all the songs, playing the part, and we'll say stuff. But do you realize that no one's really listening? Well, how do you know no one's listening? Because no lives are being changed. And I've said this before, some of the meanest people are in church. There's got to be love with what we're saying. There's got to be mercy. There's got to be grace with what we're saying. Not looking down, not judging, but not speaking to people where they're at, but speaking to where God wants to take them. Still bringing to the light to help them. But most of the time, by the way, they already know what they're doing is not right. Don't you know that drugs will kill you? You really don't need to hear that. You already know that. What I need to hear is love covers a multitude of sins. What I need to hear is God hasn't given up on you. What I need to hear is, for I know the plans I have you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. What I need to hear is, it's not the way you start, it's the way you finish, and you're still alive, and you're still breathing, which means there's still time to get it right. And God loves you, and man might have rejected you. Others might have overlooked you, but God hasn't overlooked you. God hasn't rejected you, but God loves you, and there's still time to get it right. And by the way, and all things work together for the good for those who love God and are called according to his purpose. It's not too late for God around and for you to be used for his glory and still fulfill the greatness that God's called you to. You don't have to let the drugs have the final say. So you could still throw that in, but you don't have to pound someone over the head with something that's obvious already. You know your testimony? Did you hear me sit behind the pulpit trying to convince you? Don't you know? Let's have a debate.
why you don't believe and why you're an atheist. No. We lifted up his name. I didn't even know the whole story, actually. He'd walk in. I didn't know. If I knew, it would be a different story. I would have kicked you out. No, I'm just kidding. Amen. But no, but I mean, came up, praise the Lord. I don't know what everybody else did. I'm just saying, just kept on preaching, kept on speaking, just the way I'm speaking right now. Trying to convince him, like, man, don't you know that how can you believe this way, that there's no let me show you 10, let me show you 20 things. How can you think like this? That's crazy. It takes more faith to believe not in God than to believe in God. I can go there. But look at somebody, but I'm not, and I won't. I'll let God take care of the rest. I'm going to lift up his name and the love of God and the stories. See, what's awesome about this story here is Jesus. Is it, when I go over here for you guys in the front, does it really, like, is it hard for you guys to look back? Is that uncomfortable? Good, because I hope it is uncomfortable. Amen. Yeah, especially you. Watch this. So Genesis. I'm just trying to make one way. So here he is. She's not going to church. She really doesn't want to go to church, because I'm sure many people that go to church already told her about what a woman she was and what they thought about her and her style. And I know many looked down on her, didn't even look at her. Many people on Sunday morning going to church, talking about, praise the Lord, let's change her, let's reach the people for the Lord. Walked right by her because she didn't look like them, talk like them, smell like them. But Jesus wasn't in a sanctuary outside the four walls. Went where the need was, where the people were, where the hurt was, where the pain was, where the sin. And yes, it might cost you some friendships and relationships. So, I'm just trying to get to one place. So, just in conclusion, this is all I'm trying to do. This is all I'm trying to do. So I'm just trying to do one thing. Verse 34. So, Jesus said, "My food," said Jesus, "is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say 4 months more than the harvest? I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Even now the reaper draws his wages. Even now the harvest, to harvest the crop of for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be together. Thus the saying, one sows, another reaps, is true. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the hard work, and you have not, and you have reaped the benefits of their labor." Do you understand what God is saying here? So prophetically, I'm not. Yeah, this isn't me. This is right now. This is God speaking right now. You know what God is saying? If you even look in the direction of souls, I'll give them to you. Seeds have been planted. The word's gone forth. It's all been set up. And all you have to do, all we have to do, is just make ourselves available and willing to let somebody know that there is an answer, and his name is Jesus. Be willing. We're about to witness and be part of the greatest harvest of souls ever. Where others have labored, God says, I'm going to give you the you are. We're going to reap a great harvest of souls where others have died, laid down their lives. It's cost them everything. Are we willing just to get a little uncomfortable for that? Just a little? Can we just a little? Can we just, knowing that, instead of bringing the clothes that you want to throw away to the church to make you feel better, look, I gave. No, that's junk. If you wouldn't wear it, if you were on the street, if you were struggling, would you wear what you're giving to the church to give to others? Or would you give to someone that's in need? And if you know you wouldn't, and you wouldn't wear it yourself, then don't bring it. Dispose of it yourself. Oh, look at what I'm doing. Look what I'm bringing. The devil is a liar. Get your junk out of here. Said, I'm giving you the greatest harvest. So all you got to do is just be willing, and we can't even give. Okay, you want to bless, and you're going to get other stuff. At least the stuff you're giving. Say, okay, you know what? I got three of this. I'm going to give one out of the three of the shirts. Can we just at least make sure the shirt you would still wear? And if you say yes, then praise for you really, the ones that really want to be. Have great faith in me. How about don't even give your leftovers? How about you just give some brand new stuff? And say, find a family that's in need and say, we want to, here's a gift card for $500 or $400 for you, your family, and your four kids. And don't let anybody else know about it. Woo! Don't tell nobody. Just do it. Look at somebody. Just do it. Responsible for this. I'm finished. Okay. Okay, so watch this. So here it is. 39. See, Rustin, you don't show up here today if it wasn't for some. Watch this. Many of the Samaritans from the town believed in him because of the great preaching on Sunday morning. Look at something. Nope. Because of the beautiful sanctuary. Because of the sign outside the church that said, all things are possible. Because of the music they heard. Many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him. So it didn't happen inside the four walls of the church. And this was a woman that was pushed to the side, overlooked, looked down upon because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I ever did. So now she's being transparent. She's being real. She's giving glory to God. So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them. And he stayed 2 days. Watch this. And because of his words, many more became believers. They said to the woman, we no longer believe just because of what you said. Now we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Savior of the world. But it started by, would you like to come to church? It started by at work sharing some experiences of what God did on Sunday or what God has done in your life. And when was the last time, and I'm speaking to myself too, during you actually shared your story with somebody? Shared Jesus with somebody? For no other reason. I'm not talking about going through the religion. I'm talking about with the focus of, man, your heart, looking at the person, maybe the person you work with, know that they're not saved, and it's breaking, because you know if they were to die on that day, they wouldn't be going to heaven. When was the last time? When was the last time at work? Instead of, hey, trust me, I'm speaking my, trust me. When was the last time at work where you want to blow up your boss, but they're not saved? Did you ever think that maybe God put you in that place, in that position for just a season because you're the only Bible he's going to see? And maybe everybody else responds to him the way you just responded, but maybe if you respond with a smile when everybody else on the team responds differently, a seed gets planted and say, okay, wait a second, what's going on with this one? And a miracle happened. Ministries out there, not in here. You want to be a great teacher? Teach. Go Monday through Friday. You want to be a great preach? You got your pulpit's right there in front of the people that you're around Monday through Friday, and everything else, your gift will make room for you up here, and all whatever else God has for you in the church. And yeah, we need this. Don't get me wrong. I was telling somebody we need this all work. You know, yeah. But without the people, what do we? What good is a preacher behind a pulpit in a church building if there's no one in here that's not saved? And how is there going to be people in the church that's if somebody doesn't go out and let them know that there's an answer to your family, there's an answer to your addiction, there's an answer to your hopelessness, there's an answer to your physical condition, there's an answer to what you're going through, that there is hope, that there is an answer, and it's not too late, and his name is Jesus, hallelujah. Shall ya? Share something and let somebody know about church. Well, I don't know how they're going to respond. But you don't know. But if you don't, you'll never know. Just sow a seed. Let them know we got breakfast on Sunday morning. Come and join us. And then pray for them. I'm not talking about hitting people over the head. And then let your life, your greatest sermon is your life. That's what I was going to say earlier. I know we all have to continue to keep an account, examine our heart in that. Your greatest sermon is not behind this pulpit, in a sermon, in a sentence. Sometimes we get amazed by, oh my God, that was like, did you hear that? Wow, wasn't that awesome? The greatest sermon, the greatest message that you and I are going to preach is our lives. That's the greatest message. It's not something behind a pulpit where it's like, wow, that's just the Lord working through somebody. But you know what? You want to preach a great message? Somebody, man, I want to preach a message. Well, praise the Lord, didn't you know you're already preaching a message every day? Now, is it a great message, or is it a message that's bringing people closer to Jesus, or is it a message that's bringing people away from Jesus? Look at somebody, but you're preaching a message. And every one of us might not be capital P pastors, but we're all little P pastors. Greatest sermon is your... young lady, forget about what I said here. You know, that was someone said, man, I hear stuff and I'm thinking, man, who are you talking about? I'm a foolish thing. That's for real. You want to, if we're doing a top 10 in messages this year, top 10 messages preached out of this church. And I believe there's many more. But I'm going to tell you right now, you have preached the greatest message, Fire and Water, in 2017. How can you say that? Because the fruit speaks for itself. And someone shout hallelujah. I'm going to close in prayer. Dr. D, I know you had a, what does it, do you, it's up to you, whatever you feel in the spirit. I mean, if you got a couple minutes to bring it home, okay, and then we'll pray and have an altar call. Are you happy you came?
You know, I came in earlier. I saw that there were people that had lost their hope, you know, and in Romans chapter 5, beginning at verse 3, it talks about troubles and trials and how through suffering it builds character, and the character brings hope. And the hope brings the love of God. You know, and character, Christian character, is about putting Jesus first. It's no longer living for myself, I'm living for Him. And it's when we're living for Him that trials don't bother so much, because my hope is in Him, my hope isn't in this world, my hope is not in man. But my hope is in Him and Him alone. So it's through sufferings and troubles that we learn to put our hope in Him and Him alone. And then through that hope, we come to know the love of God. You know, and it's about, you know, when we become a Christian, there's a holiday often, and then comes some troubles and trials. And we think, what's this all about, you know? That's Philippians 3:10. You know, that I might know Him, the fellowship of His sufferings, you know, the troubles and trials, and then being conformable to His death, it says. You know, it is the normal Christian life is that we first get the joy of the Lord and are excited, but there are often troubles and trials that bring doubt in our mind. But our hope is in Him. Our hope is in Him alone. And what is this about? This message brings hope. This message was prophetic. This message that Gus preached was something that shook demonic powers. There was something spoken that the principalities and powers shuddered at, because it spoke a truth, and truth brings freedom. And that's what this is about, brings freedom to every man's spirit, that they might be released to be the person God has called them to be. And that's our hope. You know, God is building character, and character brings hope, and hope the love of God. So that's what we're about. And so, you know, be joyful, rejoice, because God is moving mightily in this church. That religious spirit was rebuked today. That religious spirit that controls most churches suddenly got rebuked. What happened? That's freedom. And that's what happened. Amen. Let's all stand to our feet. Praise the Lord. Don't forget, for some that don't, most of you already heard, Monday, we don't have prayer on Monday night. No more prayer on Monday nights. We're going to restructure. We're going to be doing some things on Saturday night to implement prayer. Everybody here, because we're preparing for Celebrate Recovery is going to be here on Monday nights. Amen. So that's going to, and I know God's going to use that in a very powerful way. That'll be next month. And we're going to start having information. Is that correct, Kent? What did you say about information? Jamie? Okay. Well, is there going to be like a big table? Are you guys going to have your faces on it? She said yes. Her husband said no. Pray for them. Amen. Somebody figure it out. Amen. Jamie, I'm going to go with Kent on this one. Amen. Praise the Lord. No, but they'll have information, and that's going to be awesome. Praise God. So we'll be back here on Tuesday night. Don't forget Tuesday night service here at 7 o'clock. Let's just close. I want to go back to I Believe In, you know, let's just finish with that song here. If you're in this place, I want to close in prayer and give you the opportunity to say yes to Jesus. Your miracle and your turnaround starts with a relationship with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. The Bible says those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. No matter where you've been, how long you've been there, and how much and how long. Maybe some of you here were in church and you've fallen away. The Bible says a righteous man falls 7 times, but he gets back up. Thank God for David in the Bible in Psalms 51. If you're breathing, you're still alive, which means it's time to get it right. Learn from it. Move forward and be the champion that God's called you to be. I said, learn from it, grow from it, and move forward and be the champion that God's called you to be. If you're in this place, right now, God is not intimidated with your sins, but every one of your sins. It's not the way you start, it's the way you finish. Great champions are defined by the way they start something. Great champions are defined by the way they finish something. And all things do work together for the good. For those who love God and are called according to His purpose. The key thing is for those who love God, which means relationship. Your turnaround, your miracle starts with a relationship with Him. God wants to give you a new start. Forgive you of all your sins. You have average, but you can call it the greatness. Speaking of champions in this room, time to dream again, believe again, get back up in the name of Jesus. Be the man of God that God's called you to be. Be the called you to be. Be the husband that God's called you to be. Be the woman of God that God's called you to be. Be the voice of God that God's called you to be. Rise up in the name of Jesus and be the champions that God's called you to be. There's time. And your miracle starts right now. If you're in this place, say, Pastor, that's me. I don't want to leave this place the same way I came in. There's an answer to that addiction. There's an answer to your family. There's an answer. Whatever you might be going through, there's an answer. But the greatest miracle of all, and the answer to the greatest sickness of all, is the sickness of sin that is taking people to hell. And the good gospel news here today is this. There's an answer to the sickness of sin that's killing people every day and taking them to eternal hell. His name is Jesus. Amen? There's an answer. If that's you right now, you say, Pastor SB, I know I'm not right with God. I know I need to get right with God. I'm not where I need to be. I know I'm not living right for God. Or you're like the prodigal son that's been in church, but you've fallen away. But right now, today's service, and you've heard the message and the testimony, everything that's happened, you've come to your senses just like the prodigal son. The Bible says he came to his senses. He got back up and went back to his father's house. God's grace, God's mercy, His hands of grace and mercy are stretching out to you right now and saying, come home. If that's
that's you right now, if that's you right now as we sing, please, just a few more minutes, unless it's an emergency, nobody leaving, about to witness the greatest miracle of all, miracles, and they're starting to come, and I haven't done 1, 2, 3, raise your hand, this is what it's about. If that's you right now, say, Pastor, pray for me. I want to get right with God. I'm not where I need to be. I don't want to walk in the same. I don't want to leave this place the way I came in. I want to be the man of God that God's called me to be. I want to be the woman of God that God's called me to be. If that's you, step out of your seat quickly. Come forward. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on.
I believe in you.
Come on. Look at your neighbor and ask him, do you need to be up here? I'll go with you. Come on. Come on. Don't worry about anybody else around you. Let's go. After we pray this prayer, I want all my altar workers to come forward and get around these, and people are here to pray with you after. It's
some information from you also. Very important to get plugged into church. I know some of you have been here before, but you're up here. God knows, you know, it's between you and the Lord. And I want to encourage you, when you leave this place, tomorrow, share what God did for you. Share it tomorrow with somebody. Share with somebody. You know what? What are you doing on Tuesday? I'm going to be in church on Tuesday. You want to come with me? One plants, another waters. God brings the increase. We do the possible. God does the impossible. The Bible says those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Bless the Lord, all my soul, and all that is within. Bless the soul, and forgives all my sins and heals all my disease. Forgives all my sins. Do you believe that? For God so loved the world that he gave his own begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. One mediator between heaven and earth, his name is Jesus Christ. One that died on the cross and rose from the grave on the third day, his name is Jesus Christ. What a God, what a Savior. Lift up our hands. Just lift up our hands. Watch it at home. Your altar's right where you're at. And just pray this prayer with me. Heavenly Father, I need you. I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. And I believe you sent your Son Jesus to this earth for me. To come into my heart and be Lord and Savior of my life. Wash me with your blood. Forgive me of my sins. And renew a right spirit within me. I'm all yours. Use me for your glory. I believe that those who call upon the name of Jesus shall be saved. So I believe today that I'm on my way to heaven. My sins have been forgiven. Because your word says it, I believed it, and that settles it. In Jesus' name. My altar work. I want all my altar workers, everybody that's part of prayer team, I want you up here. Come on, come on, come on. Everyone that's prayer, come on. Let's sing the song right now. Praise the Lord. God bless you. We'll see you next service. Praise the Lord.
I believe in you.